Delara! Gods, it's good to see you. I hope your being here means you've had your fill of rest. Well, you certainly earned it. Not much has happened since your last visit. I had planned for you to meet that helper I told you about, but he refuses to answer his link pearl. I do hope he's alright. We've been exchanging messages with the Aeorian Alliance throughout, though. They say the fighting has finally stopped at the Grim of the Dark, and that the Empire show no sign of movement. Which means we might actually have a moment to ourselves for a change. Seeing as you're back, maybe you could tell me more about your time in the First. Great! Oh, and if you don't mind, I'd like to ask Flamine to join us. She'll want to know what happened to Minfilia, and I think it's best she hears it from you. We'll meet you on the terrace at the House of Splendors. Delara, my, it has been too long. Tataru did mention that I would be joining you, did she not? Thank you. Words cannot well express how I've longed to know more of the First. This world Minfilia has sacrificed so much to save. But come, rest your feet. Tataru should be arriving shortly. And so Minfilia chose to pass on her gifts to the next oracle. This girl who think were named Reen. To have such a burden thrust upon her as a child, only to embrace it when given the choice. In that respect, they are quite alike. It would seem her legacy is indeed in capable hands. Delara, might I ask a favor of you when next you return to the First? Tell Reen what I cannot. To tell her, thank you. And I would offer thanks to you as well, for staying with her to the end. Begging your pardon, but could I have a word? Real! I hope you're here to tell me you received word from our helper. I wish. Nay, I've not had a peep out of him. And it's been a good long while now, too bloody long. On account of which, I'm going to sneak over the border and see if I can get a signal to him from closer up. But what if they catch you? There must be another way. Well, it ain't as if we can ask Thancred to do it. Besides, I shouldn't have no trouble picking me way through Grimmar now the fighting's died down. Gods know there's enough shadows to hide in. And it beats waiting around here twiddling me thumbs. Anyway, I just thought I'd let you know. Now, I'd best be... Ah, I nearly forgot. Cryle's at the stones and she wants a word. Something to do with the patients. She was getting ready to examine them again when I left. We best head back then. I'm sure it's important. It seems she's still examining them. Oh, I do hope it's nothing bad.
You're here. Good. So, how are they? Still locked in slumber, but otherwise in good physical health. For the present, at least.
For the present? Oh no, is something wrong with them?
I'm afraid there may be. I summoned you after detecting faint signs of instability in Thancred's corporeal ether. But subsequent examination suggested all five might be affected. And when I examined them just now, my fears were confirmed. Tellingly, the degree of instability varies between them. Thancred exhibits the most notable signs, followed by Yshtola and Urianger. The twins' ether, meanwhile, remains relatively stable, but there is a change there too if one knows to look for it.
Hold on. Isn't that the order they were called away in?
Indeed. Which leads me to believe the instability will only increase with time. Though I can but speculate, I fear this may be a symptom of a weakening link between body and soul.
By the gods! What happens if the link is broken?
I cannot say for certain. This is all unknown territory to us. Yet whatever happens, it cannot be good. Mercifully, the instability is still only slight. And you may rest assured, Master Matoya and I will do everything in our power to keep it from worsening. Be that as it may, it is imperative that you find a way to restore our friends' souls to their bodies. Thank you.
But where's she even supposed to start? We had the greatest minds in the realm hunting high and low for an answer, and they ran out of places to look.
You stated in your report that the Exarch had originally intended to reverse the summoning process by means of his own death, correct? Raha always was a reckless young fool, ready to die for the first righteous cause that came along. His plan might well have worked, but I for one am glad he never had the opportunity to see it through. Even if it does mean our friends must remain stranded a while longer. There is another way, I am sure of it. And the key lies with him, with the Exarch. Pray return to the First and apprise him and the others of the situation. We, meanwhile, will do what we can from here. And, if the fates are kind, we will have good news to share upon your return.
Ah, Delara, you're returned. I hope your time in the Source was suitably restful. But of course it wasn't. Go on. Their corporeal ether shows signs of instability. By the gods, possibility never even occurred to me. If you have returned in the hope that my research has yielded a solution, I fear you will be sorely disappointed. It's but a mercy we have the likes of Mistress Cryo and Mistress or Master Matoya to keep our friends' bodies safe while we wrestle with the problem. But they cannot forestall the separation of body and soul indefinitely. Come, the others must be told.
Pray excuse my late arrival.
Will Thancred and Rhene not be joining us?
Nay, milady. With apologies to all, they beg leave to pursue their investigation of the Empty to its conclusion. Should matters here demand their presence, however, they did assure me that they would make themselves available.
Yes, of course. Then let us proceed. I think it best that you begin by providing a summary of Mistress Kryle's findings.
I suppose it was only to be expected that some change would occur.
Yet our souls seem unaffected, to my eye at least. How long they will remain so is another question. Kryle is right. It is imperative we find a way to return to the source.
Perhaps an explanation of the method by which I brought you here will yield some inspiration. Ere I begin, it must be noted that I am by no means a gifted mage. In order to employ powerful magics, I must rely upon the Crystal Tower and its boundless reservoirs of energy. The magic that summoned you was no exception. It is a singular spell, adapted through painstaking effort from the technique that transported me to the first. To use an analogy, it works by cutting a hole in the fabric of reality. A hole tailored to the object of summoning, through which it and it alone may pass unscathed. Though I succeeded in creating said hole, I failed to latch onto my intended target. Instead of you, the spell found those close to you, and ended up summoning them in their incomplete state. I would not soon throw my life away, not after the lengths you and yours went to save it. And so long as I breathe, I will spare no effort to see you safely home. But should all else fail, and your lives be at stake, there remains one sure method.
What was that for?
How can you even entertain such thoughts? You owe your life to the Warrior of Light, and you don't get to die unless she says so.
Your followers await your divine judgment.
What did you just...
If the two of you have finished, perhaps we could return to our discussion? Rather than dwelling upon the multiple failed attempts at transference, I think it would behoove us to focus on the solitary success. I would draw your attention to the fact that our friend can travel between worlds possessed not only of her body and soul, but her personal effects besides. This is no different from the teleportation magics to which we are all accustomed. Magics that allow for the transportation of those inanimate objects one considers to be an extension of oneself.
Are you suggesting that simply by considering us her possessions, she could carry our souls back to the source upon her person?
Well, it would be nice if things were that simple for a change. But vague notions of ownership seem a rather tenuous thing to stake our lives on. So much as a moment of doubt on her part, and we'd be left floating in the rift.
Milady hath the right of it. The requisite fixity of belief would be too much to ask even of our friend. Yet were we to immure our souls within an object in her possession, mayhap then our safe passage could be assured. White Aurasite would, I believe, serve as a suitable vessel for this purpose. It was conceived to imprison the massy soul of an Ascian, and should house one of ours with relative ease. We would need only to ensure our soul's safe preservation inside the stone, and identify a means by which they might be transferred back unto our vacant bodies.
Soul preservation and transference. I believe I know of someone who may be able to assist us. On the far shore of the source, there stands a great palace built by the elves. It was forsaken in the wake of the flood, but a certain Numo chose to make their home there soon after. Though they have long lived as a recluse, they once occupied a place of honor in Verbert's royal court, and it is said that none in all of Norvrand is more knowledgeable than they on matters of the soul.
Well, I've no objection to seeking a helping hand, but if they've gone to such lengths to hide themselves away from the world, what makes you think they'd be willing to lend us one?
A worthy question. Years ago, I myself tried and failed to solicit their cooperation in the battle against the Sin Eaters. No sooner had I begun to make my plea than they unleashed a swarm of their familiars upon me. Unlike me, however, you have curried favor with the Fae Folk. By that merit alone, I am hopeful that they would grant you an audience. They may still be inclined to turn you away, of course, but if their knowledge might feasibly facilitate your return home, we have to try.
Grand Cosmos, that is, the palace we seek, stands on the opposite shore of the source. I will arrange for a boat to carry us there. Well, as thou journeyest thither, I think it best that I devote mine energies to creation of white oresite. By thy leave, of course. The process requireth no small amount of time, and should the new Mo consent to lend us their aid, we will have need of a suitable vessel ere long. Agreed. Then I would ask the rest of you to meet me in Solon, and do be prepared for a warm reception. As I told you before, I had scarcely set foot on the palace grounds when I was set upon by our host familiars, and I expect our reception today to be no different. Which is why I propose we march through the main gate, weapons drawn. I'm sorry, but are we not here to petition for assistance? I cannot honestly think barging in looking for a fight is going to persuade them. Actually, I believe the Exarch may have the right of it. They have no doubt poured a great deal of time and energy into their creations. Were I them, I should be most interested to meet with those who could overcome my defenses. As would any true seeker of knowledge, and there is little we can say or do to convince them to help us if we know nothing of their character, nor less why they chose to hide themselves from the world. But if we can seize their interest, mayhap we can earn ourselves an audience. Weapons drawn it is, then. Though I must say, Exarch, you certainly seem to be enjoying all this. Do I? Well, I will not deny that I enjoy the thought of fighting alongside you all rather than pacing about inside the Crystal Tower. You both seem to be in rather high spirits. If you ask me, not that I'm surprised, your moods invariably improve when Delara's around. What exactly are you implying? She averted a calamity and the light which seemed destined to consume her has been extinguished. It's only natural that we'd be pleased to see her. Yes, well, you will have plenty of time to celebrate her good health after we finish here. Of course. Well, let's proceed to the palace. Thank you.
underestimate me!
You. such was my fiercest familiar. Oh, impressive.
Hey, Cloak. Tis good to see you again after all these years. And judging by your vigorous greeting, I dare say the feeling is mutual. To be sure, a simple shake of the hand would have sufficed by way of welcome, but I shan't complain. But you must be wondering as to the purpose of our visit. We come to beg your assistance in a most urgent matter.
Shake? Beg?
Our comrades' very souls are in danger. If we are to save them, we will need the benefit of your unsurpassed knowledge on the matter. Please, will you not sit and hear our plea?
Oh, how dare you! How dare you speak thus in my presence! It was to escape such words of temptation that I hid myself from the world of men. You are sinners, one and all, and I swore never again to have any part in your affairs.
I can only imagine what terrible events forced you into a life of seclusion. But I know that the Numo are a good and noble folk. It is not in your nature to turn a blind eye to the plight of those around you. And in treating with us, I am certain whatever mistrust you feel for man will begin to heal.
Be satisfied? Oh, I suppose I could listen. After all, there's no harm in just... No! I mustn't. Not again. That damn court mage seemed to have the best of intentions too, and countless innocents died for my naivety. Oh, you know not what you ask of me. What horrors my knowledge has wrought. You know of the plague? Then you know how dangerous soulcraft can be. Instead of saving your friends, you risk damning them. Are you sure you're willing to take that chance?
No. No.
Oh, very well. I will hear your petition, but that is all. And I expect fitting payment for my troubles.
Commensurate with your contribution to our cause. No more and no less, I promise you. With that settled, might I impose upon you to join us at the Quisterium? I'm afraid the nature of my friend's predicament calls for absolute secrecy.
There you are. The others have gone ahead of the Crystal Tower with Bayluk. For the record, I truly wish we hadn't had to resort to using such words when treating with them. I had ever sought to convince, not compel. Yet, I cannot deny that a part of me is glad Yoriage shared his knowledge of the new metal with us. Had he not, Beck Luke wouldn't be here. Speaking of whom, we should hurry. To keep our guests waiting would only add insult to injury. We mustn't dally here any longer, Delara. Bay Luke is to hear the truth of our travails in the first. You, of all people, should be present.
Tell me not only that the return of night was your doing, but that you hail from another world as well?
Everything we told you, of the source, the shards, the seven umbral calamities, all of it is true. I realize how fantastical it sounds, and I would not blame you for doubting our testimony. But given your expertise, you must surely have noted the peculiar nature of their souls.
Any other time and I would have dismissed your stories as balderdash and flummery. But upon closer inspection, 'tis plain their souls are far denser than is normal, and that they do not possess true bodies. Save you, your body is your own. And your soul is the densest of them all.
As I said before, were it not for their heroism, the skies over Norvrant would still be awash with light, the realm yet at the mercy of 4-3 and the Sin Eaters. After all they have done for our home, seeing them safely back to their own, it seems the very least we can do.
Your tale is intriguing. Yes, very intriguing indeed. Simply to hear it is fitting payment in itself. As for your friends, I can but agree. Their valorous deeds on behalf of Norvrant are deserving of recognition, of their own fitting payment.
You will help us then?
I will. I would see my knowledge put to good use for a change. I do have one condition, however. I am not the spry young Numo I once was. As such, I will require assistance in my fieldwork and testing.
It would be our pleasure. We'll be laboring for our own benefit after all.
You have spun quite a tale, but tell me, have you given any thought as to how you might return to your world? White Oricite, you say? An intriguing proposition. But one which fails to account for the present state of your souls. They have become highly charged, likely as a consequence of having maintained tangible forms for so long. In such an energetic, unstable state, there is no telling what may happen to their souls within the Oricite. They could very well become immutable to transference, never to be restored to their bodies. Then, would it be possible to force our souls into a state of dormancy prior to transference? In theory, yes, but the soul is not a candle to be snuffed out and relit on a whim. Well, that sounds ominous. What exactly would rendering our souls dormant entail? In order to maintain a corporeal form, your souls constantly draw ether from your surroundings. This process must be halted, and the resulting surfia of ether removed. Your minds would ultimately be separated from these fox bodies of yours, rendering you incapable of interacting with the world around you. A cruel fate under normal circumstances, but one which will be rectified upon your return home. Leaving lifeless husks, like those poor souls at the end of Journey's Head, corrupted by the Sin Eaters, their ether made stagnant by the light. Corrupted? Stagnant? Might I see these unfortunate individuals? Why? Do you think you might be able to help them? I might, or I might not, but I shall know for sure until I have seen their condition firsthand. Then I would be glad to take you to them, on the understanding that you won't do anything which might increase their suffering. It was my faith in man I lost, not my compassion. Well, I see no need for us to accompany you. While you escort our guests to the inn, I will assist Orianje in creating the requisite oresight. I believe my talents would be better applied to that endeavor as well. Might I leave the three of you to assist Beluk as necessary? Let us make for Almerang then. So this is Hauric, is it? Yes, as the third balance leans perilously toward the light. Towards stasis. What do you suppose will happen to him? Not too bright, are you, boy? The same as all poor souls corrupted by the light, he will become a Sin Eater. You don't know that. We defeated the Wardens and banished the light from the night sky. Hauric was completely unresponsive before, but now... Then perhaps there is yet hope. If I may, there is a treatment I wish to administer to the patients. What sort of treatment? In the course of my studies of the soul, I once created a tonic which could temporarily stimulate the ether in one's body. After some refinement, it came to be used by the Knights of Volbert. Then for far darker purposes. Lest it fall into the wrong hands, I swore never again to make it. But for their sakes, I will break that oath. It is not like to reverse the stagnation, mind you, but it should offer some measure of relief. Soul Tonic. This potent tonic invented by Beluk during the time of Volbert is said to revitalize the soul both figuratively and literally. Bottoms down the hatch. Totten stares blankly at you. It would seem the tonic has had no effect. What is this warmth I feel in my chest? Must have felt cold for a long time. I feel warm, and my legs, they don't feel as heavy.
Now then, have you noted any change in the patients?
A notable rise in body temperature and increased motor function.
and most of the patients at least. The more severely afflicted showed no response. As I feared then. 'Tis true that with the restoration of night, the corrupting influence of light would no longer grow. And yes, their bodies will naturally return to the equilibrium given time. But this holds true only for their corporeal aether, their incorporeal aether, that of the soul is not so easily mended. Which is why those in later stages of corruption like Halric appear unaffected by your tonic. Precisely. The boy's soul is too far gone, his mind held together by the finest of threads. There is a chance he may one day recover, of course, but it could take years, decades even. By the gods, he could wake to find himself an old man. A fine reward for his persistence, the opportunity to mourn the life he never had a chance to live. No, there must be something we can do. Look, I realize this is not why we petitioned your aid, but do you think it possible we can find a way to hasten the recovery? Maybe. Nor do I think it impossible that in treating them, we might learn something of relevance to your own predicament. I suspect the Crystal Exarch has told you of my past. I was once a mage of the Royal Court of Volbert, and that soulcraft was my field of study. The tonic you administer to the patients here is one of the fruits of my labors. I hope to do great things for the kingdom. But in the end, my knowledge brought only suffering, a plague the like of which none had ever seen. At the hands of unscrupulous men, what should have been my greatest triumph instead became my greatest shame. That I do! A comforting thought indeed. Well, let us return to the task at hand, finding a means by which we might revitalize these peoples in corporeal ether.
Do you think it can be done?
Where the sky is still ablaze with the primordial light, I would call it an exercise in futility. But now we may have a chance. The method I have in mind will entail the conjuring of a familiar. They are able to amplify the energies poured into them, making them the perfect conduit for the ether revitalizing magics we will ultimately employ.
If you're about to launch into a lengthy explanation of the metaphysics of your plan, don't bother. I'd rather get on with doing whatever it is that needs to be done if it's all the same to you. Whatever regents must be procured or spells invoked, I'll do it.
I admire your spirit. Very well. Your first task will be to gather the necessary materials. The purest of waters and finest of clays, as well as a fey lantern brimming with pixie magic.
If you're convinced the resulting familiar could help the patients, fine.
Alfino, the water and clay will be simple enough, but I think you know what we'll have to do to get the lantern. You don't mean...
The pixies took quite a liking to us before. If we humor them with our company, I'm sure they'll be willing to help us. Fine. We'll pay a visit to Il Meg, though I never thought you would be the one to suggest going back there.
I'm impressed you've been there at all, let alone befriended the Fey folk. Oh, while you're about it, seek out the new Moa of Platin A. They will be able to supply you with water suitable for our needs.
Right. Let's get this over with, shall we?
There still remains the matter of the clay. Might I prevail upon you to find it? Clay from Amarang would likely be best. Know you of anyone who might be able to assist us? Ah, yes! They will be able to point you in the right direction, I am sure. While you and the twins are occupied, I will see if there is aught else I can learn of the stagnation which afflicts the people here.
Laura, well, what a coincidence.
You've come at a good time. We've just this moment finished repairing the talus and trolley you lot took to Nabatharang. Blah, 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 blah. The trolley was no trouble, but the talus would have been another matter had we not had a visit from Master Chai. He offered us a share of the leftover building materials from Daedalus Stoneworks, as well as a few trade secrets to help us along. Clever man, that Chai News. He seemed pretty keen on the ideas I had for putting the giant talus to work. Like a giant trolley! But Magnus still refuses to see all the goo we could do with it. You're entitled to your dreams, jerk, but that doesn't mean you can go harassing our guests with them. Master Chai was just being polite. And something tells me the Lara here didn't come all this way to talk about trolleys. What is it you need, friend? I see. And this familiar requires clay from Omerang. Well, look no further. If anyone can find you some quality clay, it is us. Saying that, it isn't exactly a commodity nowadays, but there must be some lurking somewhere or other, waiting to be dug up. If I'm not mistaken, there was a time when they used to take clay from Mount Barren mines to make adobe bricks. Place is swarming with coyotes now, but if you're after the good stuff, you could do worse than look there.
The twins have returned, and in one piece at that. I was convinced the pixies would turn at least one of them into a Gornormit, but no. You have the clay, I take it?
Pristine clay, a finely grained soil material found in Omerang.
Wonderful! We need to combine the clay and the water, then heat the mixture with the Fey Lantern. After that, it will be a simple matter of settling upon a suitable form and performing the necessary incantation.
Beg Luke, I have a question. In the event that we had need of the spell and you weren't around, would it be possible for another to perform the incantation?
Assuming they possess the requisite skill, yes. Arik and the others have suffered so much, and I swore to do everything in my power to save them. If there is a chance the spell could do that, I would be the one to invoke it.
Maybe you should be the one to do so. A deep understanding of the subject's physical state, combined with a strong desire to help them, can drastically increase the magic's effect, and you are plainly more familiar with these people than I.
I dare say there are few in all Norvra more dedicated to finding a cure. Is that not so, Dalara?
I'll give it my all. For Halric, for Tesleen.
Then we're all of a mind on the matter. Alizé should be the one to conjure the familiar.
Let us begin. I trust you've prepared the clay. Very good. Now, I would have you sculpt for me a pawksy. Plump, with floppy ears and a short curly tail.
A pawksy. I think I know what you mean. There we are. How's that?
Wow.
Well, it is certainly creative. There's no denying that.
Yes, yes, I'm no artist. Very funny.
Pay him no mind, child. Though it may look like a grotesque parody of reality, it is what the Invoker believes that matters.
You're not helping.
But I speak the truth. If successful, this incantation will turn imagination into reality. Which is why the only thing of import is what you believe this figure embodies. You must focus. Hold the Porksy's image steady in your mind's eye. Now then, as I taught you, relax and allow your energies to flow.
With flesh of clay, I bid thee rise, on wings of dreams to touch the skies. What once was idle fantasy, I call forth to reality!
Not bad for a first attempt. Now, let us see what can be done for young Halric. Through the operation of the magics you invoked to animate this familiar, it is now replete with the energies required to stir the boy's soul. You need but give it a name, and it will do as your heart desires.
A name. All right, I've decided. Now. Go, Angelo!
How is he, Beluk? Did it work? I believe it did. You and your fledgling familiar have done well. If my eyes do not deceive, a hint of color has returned to his soul. Gods, I would jump for joy if I weren't so exhausted. We're so close now, Halric.
As you are even now in the process of discovering, this magic asks much of the invoker. Well, you may not have realized that the same is also true of the subject. As such, we must proceed with caution. However, with further treatment, I have the utmost confidence the boy will make a full recovery. Observing the reanimation of his stagnant soul has been most enlightening. I will need time to put my theories to the proof, but I believe I can fashion a spell to produce the opposite effect. That is, to induce stagnation. Thus enabling our safe transport back to the source via Orosite. A thought occurred to me about this treatment. Then Luke said when the soul is rendered dormant, the mind is separated from the body, that a person becomes incapable of interacting with the world around them. Does that not sound like a lot like some of the tempered back in the source? Not really. It is the fate of most tempered to become slaves to primals, save in a handful of cases. Or am I missing something? If I can master this technique, the art of revitalizing the soul, I know of at least one of the sorts who could desperately use such treatment. Exactly! His condition is uncannily similar to Howarick's, is it not? The only difference being that his soul was suffused with Earth-expected ether instead of light. It follows that if his soul is subject to a similar kind of stagnation, there may be a chance we can save him, right? Forgive me, but who is this Gabu fellow of whom you speak? I see. His condition does sound similar, yet there is much more about the soul that remains unknown even to me. I say this not to discourage you, you understand, but to remind you that this is delicate work we do here, work requiring patience. Of course, and as long as there is hope for the patients here, I will devote whatever time is needed to see this through. But I refuse to spend that time in idleness. If it's all the same to you, I'd like to stay here with Angelo and continue with their treatment. The two of you should return to Crystarium with Bad-Luke and see if you can't make some headway with their newly posited theories. I would tell you to rest first, but I see you're not to be convinced. Ah, the fire of youth. Let us return to the Crystarium then. Finally, I found you! Kaishir, what are you doing on the way out here? There's trouble back in Yulmore. Lady Chai is beside herself, sighing, pacing the whole lot. Near enough begged me to go and find you. Sighing and pacing, you say? It must be urgent. I take it I will be returning to the Crystarium alone. Go on then, it's not as if I have anything for you to do. Thank you, Bad-Luke. Sorry for bothering you and all that, but she says the future of Yulmore is at stake. Lady Chai's up in the parlor. Best not keep her waiting, eh? Well, not here seems out of the ordinary, though I do not see Lady Chai anywhere. Probably pacing around outside again, staring off into the distance and all that, sighing. Strange. Let's see if we can find her and discover the source of her distress.
Lady Chai, whatever is the matter?
I knew not where else to turn. Oh, this is all too much for my poor heart to bear alone.
Alone? What of Master Chai?
But that is the very reason I summoned you. He's gone.
What? What happened?
It all began after the events at Mount Golg. With Lord Vorthry out of the way, we all agreed that a new leader must be chosen.
And so you held an election?
Yes, well, sort of. Not a single person volunteered to stand, you see. After a lifetime of leisure, we free citizens have grown somewhat indolent. Readapting to the harsh realities of life is trying enough, but to take charge of a broken city as well? No one wanted such responsibility. Nevertheless, Yulmore could not well do without a leader, and so we decided that anyone and everyone should be considered a candidate. And after we cast our ballots and tallied the votes, the mayorship fell upon my dear husband.
Well, given the manner in which he orchestrated the construction of the giant Talos, none could deny his leadership qualities.
But even before then, he had proven himself at Daedalus Stoneworks, don't forget. He is more than qualified for the role. The perfect choice. Indeed, I told him as much when his victory was first announced. But perhaps I was too forceful in my attempt to encourage him. For shortly after that, he vanished without a word.
You believe he was so daunted by the burden of leadership that he felt compelled to flee? Please, Lady Chai, dry your eyes. Your husband does not strike me as the sort of man who would abandon his duty, much less his beloved wife. There has to be some other reason for his absence.
You truly think so? What about you? What do you think has become of my husband?
And there you have it, Lady Chai. You needn't worry. Master Chai loves you more than all the world, and he will return. Wherever he may have gone, rest assured we will find him.
Thank you, my dear boy. You have set my mind at ease. I will trust in my husband and await his return.